And they did manage to get in their truck, but the water was so full by then pushing the truck that got out, and that's when the water took them down the creek. Well, his wife and two kids did manage to get a hold of the tree, and, you know, they were found.
74 mobile homes in Massieville were destroyed. 40 homes sustained major damage, as did 7 businesses. Lorin Schultz followed a Worthington couple to Massieville as they went to check on their daughter and grandson. Lorin is in our newsroom now. Lorin?
Angela, that woman and her son lived in a mobile home park that literally lifted up off its foundation and floated for hundreds of feet. Now, I was allowed into the scene just as authorities were letting people who live there get back in to see the devastation to their homes.
Her expando is in my bedroom.
Limo! A rain dog
it! It sure did, didn't it, hon?
When Carol's parents arrived here from Worthington, they found Carol and her son, Brandon, safe. But life, as Carol has known it, has been washed away.
Shot, stunned, I mean, guess I was just glad I wasn't down here when it did happen. There's nothing but mud on the floor, and everything's soaking wet. And I have a trailer in my back bedroom.
It's so very hard to believe that this little creek overflowed its banks and caused as much devastation as it did. At one point, Carol says the water was over the top of her trailer. Everyone realizes they are lucky. It could have been much worse. They can rebuild, right? Not really. Most of these people did not have flood insurance.
You have to get flood insurance, you have to go through the state, and it's real expensive. You call an insurance company down here and they won't give you flood insurance, period.
So they walk off with memories in hand, walking toward an uncertain future. Carol doesn't know where she's going to go. No money, no food, no home. The governor has declared a state of emergency in Ross County, but that does little to soothe the emotional wounds of these flood-stricken people. Angela and Cabot, these victims, flood victims, are still in shock. It's going to take a very long time for them to lift out of this problem. And the rescue workers, well, they are beyond the point of exhaustion.
Lorin, do you know whether or not there are people from neighboring communities who are coming in offering to help?
There are people from everywhere coming in to help. That's probably the one bright side of the whole thing. Whenever there's a disaster, people from everywhere come in to help. And some of the rescue people in the sheriff's department are trying to actually keep some people away because there's just too many people flocking to the scene. The best way probably people can help is by assisting the Red Cross or sending money to the Red Cross. That probably would be the best way.
The governor has declared that area a disaster area, yes, so that means some help will be coming.
Absolutely.
Picking up the pieces from the flash floods that have wrecked their lives. And finally, they're getting a little bit of help. A National Guard convoy has rolled into Massieville tonight.
Guardsmen will start first thing in the morning, clearing away debris and rebuilding what they can.
But it's going to be a huge job. The worst flash flooding in 30 years has left 2 people dead, dozens others homeless, and a big part of Massieville in ruins.
4 inches of rain in just 2 hours transformed the normally docile Indian Creek into a killer, forcing the people of Massieville to hold on for life. At first light today, the devastation was complete. More than 100 homes and businesses damaged or destroyed.
Mud, dirt, so people lost everything.
But any cleanup had to wait. Rescue crews and canine teams from 4 states were called in to search for 2 people swept away in Sunday's floodwaters. One of them, a man who had just himself rescued 2 elderly women.
He stopped his motorcycle and the waves pushed him over. He couldn't get to him.
Late today, rescue crews recovered the body of David Theobald, a young father of 2. And then, within about a half an hour, a National Guard helicopter found the other victim, Anna Fields, about 5 miles farther downstream.
I can go walk through a lake to get mine.
Tonight, the people of the small Ross County town are just getting back to find out what's left of their homes.
Start all over again, I reckon.
We all right, honey.
But it's going to take a while. Life here in the quiet countryside south of Chillicothe has been changed, some say forever, by a freak summer storm.
Because I've lost everything, and just wondering where I'm going to go after this.
They have not officially added it up, but the damage obviously will be in the millions, and rebuilding what can be rebuilt, it's going to take months at least.
Oh, it's just horrible down there. I mean, how are people coping with this?
Well, I was down there all day long, and I got to tell you, the people are coping great. I mean, we see natural disasters like this from time to time, and there's a strength that comes over people. They kind of pull together. The people in Massieville are very lucky because they have each other, and it was a really kind of a, hate to say, a nice thing to see. It was a neat thing to see in the face of real adversity.
Yeah, it seems like a real close-knit community.
It is.
Much luck to them. Of course, as we said, damage in that tiny town was so extensive that Governor Voinovich spent part of the night with the people in Massieville to talk with them and to take a tour of the destruction. Our Marcy Fleisher was with the governor tonight, and she joins us live now. Marcy?
Well, Bob and Carol, to bring you up to date, first of all, it's very quiet here. I think people are trying to get the rest they so badly need after such a long, long day. As you mentioned, Governor Voinovich was here this evening. He spent about an hour here. First, he toured the area from the air, then on the ground, and he met with several people here. It was their job to impress upon the governor how badly they need some federal help. Melissa Posey welcomed Governor Voinovich's kind words, but they did little to stop her tears. The market she owns with her husband is a total loss.
It just ruined everything. The floor's all hooved up, and it's a total loss. You know, we have no insurance or anything, no flood insurance on it.
Thanks to friends and neighbors, the cleanup has begun here. But the Poseys have no idea how they'll rebuild.
You know, if it was just us, it wouldn't be so bad. We have a 4- to 8-year-old to take care of. So it makes it a lot rougher.
The governor visited other businesses destroyed by the flood. Larry Diehl owns the Massieville General Store. Some 2.5 feet of water wiped away much of his wares.
Wise, I probably got neighborhood 150 to 250,000 probably. I mean, I got new water heaters, new water pumps all in a pile.
Diehl says he's lucky he's got some flood insurance, but he pleaded with the governor to come up with assistance for those who don't.
We give billions of dollars to Russia, Kuwait. Charity begins at home. Let's have some help here.
The governor is hoping the help will come from the federal government. If the president declares an emergency disaster area here, grants to rebuild will be available. But until that's determined, the governor urged people to just hold on.
Ultimately, things will get better, and not to despair.
I think that is some heartfelt advice, but certainly it's not easy to take right now. As I mentioned, things are quiet, but take a look behind me. The owner of the Massieville General Store, Larry Diehl, he tells me he's going to be up all night tonight watching what little he has left inside the store. There are still some National Guardsmen here keeping watch over the town, but Larry tells me he's not taking any chances with what he's got left.
You know, Marcy, earlier I was down there, Larry was telling us that his father owned that store since the 30s, and he just said, I'm glad my dad didn't have to see this. This has really been an ordeal for these people.
As you mentioned, it's been so tough for us to watch. And as you said, the only thing that gives anyone any hope is how this community has come together. And I think as soon as you see the first light here tomorrow morning, they're going to be back out here because certainly there is lots to do.
All right, Marcy, thanks very much for the update tonight from Ross County.
As we've told you, damage in Massieville is extensive. Many people there have lost everything. The Red Cross tells us tonight that 126 homes are affected or damaged. 3 are destroyed. 76 mobile homes are also damaged. 35 are destroyed. If you would like to help, you can send your donation to the
disaster area south of Chillicothe.
Yeah, you're not going to believe this, but it seems looters now are stealing from the flood victims down in Massieville. They have reportedly been stripping aluminum from damaged trailers and stealing just about anything that is not held down. Our Tim Waller is in Massieville with the latest on the cleanup effort.
It was bound to happen sooner or later. Some of the people we're talking to here in Massieville complained that at least 2 men were seen here last night looting. Now, one guy that I talked to a little while ago said at about 1 o'clock in the morning, a couple of guys were right behind a Massieville laundromat. They're also hanging out at homes, businesses. Somebody even saw the 2 men in a boat along Indian Creek picking up extension cords, lawnmowers, anything they could get their hands on. The bigger complaint is that the local sheriff's department, residents say, is not staying here overnight to make sure that looting doesn't take place. Well, today it's going to get even busier. The National Guard has been in town for a couple of hours. They're going going to try to get some of the mess cleaned up. Another complaint we're hearing is that the guard right now is focusing on getting state property, state roads cleaned up. They're not doing a great deal to help residents get their belongings put back, trying to salvage whatever's left from the big flood. But probably the biggest issue today is the Federal Emergency Management Agency is back in town assessing the damage on businesses and homes. About 79 mobile homes were destroyed in Sunday's flooding. Businesses were also wrecked. About 40 other individual homes received major damage in the flood. The big question is, when will somebody see money, whether it be federal, state, or local assistance? A very busy atmosphere here today in Massieville, and of course, we'll have a little bit more on this later in the day. In Massieville, Tim Waller, Eyewitness News.
Of course, two people did die in that flooding, and as Tim said, officials there are trying to assess the amount of damage. They should have a figure for us later today. Governor Voinovich, meantime, has said that he will petition the government.
This homes filled with mud. In fact, you can see the high water mark on the television set here. Obviously, it is going to take a long, long time to get Massieville back to normal.
Tim Waller has been in Massieville for the last 2 days, and he has found a couple of people who say the town is not getting enough help to clean up. Tim?
That's right, Dave and Andrea. It's been a very busy day here, but a day mixed with a lot of frustration and a lot of confusion. I think most of the confusion out here in Massieville is over the National Guard's visit. Of course, they came rolling into this town this morning in a convoy. We do have pictures of that from earlier this morning. They came here specifically with one thing in mind, to clean up the roads and property along Indian Creek, anything considered public domain. That was their mission here. But I think a lot of the Massieville residents, a lot of the flood victims, had the idea that they were coming to lend a helping hand to some of the homeowners. There is a lot of work to be done here. But later in the day, we were told by the National Guard that is not the case. The National Guard's mission here is to stick to the public domain. And right now, most of the work being done is by volunteers and by individual homeowners themselves. A lot of other work going on here today. They're actually resurfacing some of the roads which were washed away. Power, I understand, has been restored to most of the homes. Of course, the homes still standing. A lot of the service is no longer needed as a result of the flood. So Dave and Andrea, one of the biggest things today is a visit from the Federal Emergency Management Agency. Those are the people that will decide how much money is needed here. Now, one thing I do want to point out, and it's very important for people to understand, in Massieville, federal funds only become available after state funds are exhausted, after local funds are exhausted.
Right.
Then the federal government kicks in that money. So a lot of questions being asked and a lot of busy work going on. Volunteers still busy at work, as you can see here behind me. A lot more to be done.
Tim, let me ask you, we had reports earlier today of looting in the area. Have you heard anything more about that?
Right. A couple of the property owners have complained. They saw a couple of guys in the area looting. As far as I understand, there has been no arrest by the sheriff. Of course, that's one of the things that's going to happen in a situation like this. Somebody said they saw a couple of guys in a boat going down Indian Creek, picking up lawnmowers, picking up extension cords, anything worth money. Of course, Terry Sullivan's going to give us a full report on that at 6 o'clock with Bob and Carol.
All right.
Thanks a lot, Tim. Well, also in today's news, there is hope tonight for at least 59 children in the county whose parents have failed to provide child.
Already saturated ground, triggering new flood warnings for Franklin County and, for that matter, much of southern and south central Ohio. Wires and trees were blown down, including this tree in Clintonville that fell into the intersection of Calumet and North Broadway. This latest storm adds to our record July rainfall. And it comes on the same day that Governor Voinovich has extended the emergency order. He's now added 4 new counties to the 16 already on the map for federal aid. Now, one of the new counties added, Ross County.
And that includes the flood-ravaged town of Massieville. Marcy Fleisher went back to Massieville tonight, where a new flood warning was sounded, and she joins us live from there now. Marcy?
Well, 2 storms came through this area tonight, one about an hour ago and one earlier this evening. They both brought with them some rain, some lightning, some thunder. The good news, though, it didn't bring any more flood water. However, it was enough to make plenty of people here plenty nervous.
They stood on the banks, keeping a watchful eye on the creek that had flooded just days ago.
Now, whenever people heard it, we was going to have some more rain, and, you know, people was kind of watching and, you know,
wondering what was going to happen.
The Power family was busy cleaning when they got word a storm was on its way.
And the sheriff come through announcing on his speaker that there was a thunderstorm heading this way. Could have as much as 2 inches of rain.
You know, when you look out here and you saw this rain, the first thing you think is, you know, we got a little hysterical, you know, bringing stuff in.
Fearing the worst, the Powers took precautions with possessions they have left.
This is why the plastic on it. We didn't want any more water than what we've already had.
Again, there was some more rain tonight, but no flooding. You may notice that I'm surrounded by lots of stuff here. This used to be inside the Rozelle Creek Market. You may remember the market because we introduced you to the market Monday. Well, on Monday, it was muddy, all water torn. It was really a terrible sight. Take a look what is going on here now. Lots of people busy working. This place is really being totally rehabbed. This is a brand new floor. The walls have been painted. And within just a couple days, it's a complete transformation. If you remember, the owner of this store, Melissa Posey, came to Governor Voinovich Monday in tears, asking for help. Melissa joins us now. You still got lots of people working. You said this has been going on around the clock. You must look around, and I don't know, it blows my mind.
We've had a lot of help. If it wasn't for the community, we wouldn't have made it. They've really helped us out a lot, and we really appreciate everything they've done for us. They've been here around the clock for about 3 days.
Well, it is terrific. I know you have a big thank you to all the people here. That is the story tonight. More cleanup and the good news, no more flooding.
We have certainly learned the people of Massieville are fighters. We know that. Marcy,
no
thanks
doubt
a
about
lot.
It.
Thanks for the update.
Mike Moore knows how to keep on going through the worst of times. Earl has not only battled that flood, but cancer and a house fire, too. Tonight, we're happy to say Mike's well on his way to rebuilding his card collection. As Terry Sullivan reports, that's thanks to you.
You gave him an Emma already. You gave him an Emma, a Russell, and a Thurman Palmer.
Over at the picnic table, the McSurley boys are working on a special project.
Makes me pretty mad, your cards. I mean, for all your time and effort and money, you get into it, and something messes them up, it's pretty bad.
They're taking bits and pieces of a hobby they love and putting it in a special bundle for a fellow card collector. Mike Moore, an 18-year-old former cancer patient whose library of sports figures was just about washed away in Sunday's flood.
Which one's the most special?
This is a real good card. This is a hologram, and they're very rare.
11-year-old Chris says he got the idea after watching our story yesterday.
The whole box costs about, say, $36, or about a dollar a pack. And
even 8-year-old Steven wants to pitch in. He spent his whole allowance on this Babe Ruth card.
And I go to church and I think that it's right that you should help your neighbor like it says in the Bible. If your friend's in need or something, you should give him something. I'm turning a spider. I thought this would just give you a little start to start over, you know.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate this.
I know what it feels like when you lose something.
See, now even no luck can be good luck, not bad luck.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Sure can. Really appreciate it.
In the flood water after he saved two other women's lives. Phil Hayes attended the funeral for a friend.
Amazing grace, how sweet.
Whether it was at home, at work as a prison guard, or cruising on a Harley Davidson, David Theobald was surrounded by people who loved him very much. They called him Bubba.
Everyone loved Bubba. He was a friend to everybody. He'd do anything for anybody.
His ultimate sacrifice may have been his life. He drowned after he saved two women trapped in flood water.
So he did what Jesus did. He laid down his life.
We've been unable to find the women that David Theobald saved from the flood that ripped through here. No one seems to know who they are. But helping strangers was something David Theobald did a lot of. Anita Proctor moved in next door to the Theobalds just 3 weeks ago. He introduced himself by offering to help them move in.
I guess he figured I wasn't very strong, so he'd come over and give us a hand, you know. He didn't say much, but he helped us out.
His death shredded the hearts of many, because with his life went his heart, something no one wants to live without.
Dave was a man's man, but when it come down to tenderness, Dave had a real soft heart. He just loved everybody.
David Theobald, they say, was simply someone special. Phil Hayes, WSYX Channel 6 News, Waverly, Ohio.
And 61-year-old Anna Fields also drowned in that flood. She will be buried Saturday. In the meantime, 45 people from the Ohio Civilian Conservation Corps have been brought in for a couple of weeks to help with the cleanup. They're going to replace the Ohio National Guard, which is planning to pull out tomorrow. The Guard.